During this video, I will take you further into the topic of smart grids and smart charging. Recently, my mother passed away, and during the last years of her life, we would often visit her in the hospital, and she would be laying there, surrounded by all the electrical equipment of the hospital, keeping her alive. And I wondered, what would happen if somehow the electricity grid failed right now? Would we be using emergency lights, just like the surge in Myanmar on the photo? Would I do something about it? I fantasized they would broadcast something like, "Ladies and gentlemen, there has been a power outage, so in order to keep this hospital running, we request all visitors with electric vehicles leave them parked outside of the hospital so we can use their batteries as backup power." That would have been a great example of smart charging. Smart charging is about using solar optimally. This is on my roof, for example, and most days it produces more than enough energy to provide both my house and my car with energy. Smart charging would mean that I charge my car on the middle of the day when the sun shines most brightly. And I work at home, so no problem for me. Our electricity is increasingly also coming from wind parks on the North Sea in the Netherlands, which are now realized without any subsidies, by the way. During the night, these parks go on producing electricity, but there's so little demand for it during the night that they often have to throw away this energy. Smart charging would mean that your car could be charged during the night when there's an excess of wind energy. In order to calculate the possibilities of smart charging, I got sponsoring from ELAT, NL Foundation, to build a model at the Eindhoven University of Technology called Spark City, and it uses the GAMA platform. I cannot describe it in detail, but if you're interested, you can find more information on the website sparkcity.org. In Spark City, we created virtual neighborhoods based on GIS data of real neighborhoods. In and around those neighborhoods live a number of agents that are visualized here. So we have people in houses using energy, moving around. We have car manufacturers, dealers selling them electric vehicles. We have charge point operators, municipalities that can initiate charge points at home, work, or in the streets. And when the electric cars use the charge points, they are connected to a realistic electricity grid. This grid has, among other things, solar, wind, and a spot market. When cars charge, they can optimize the moment of charging using a simple linear algorithm that looks for the lowest price. Let's pretend, for a moment, these neighborhoods are running almost entirely on solar energy. That would generate a big peak in electricity generation around noon, which you can see as a yellow bump on the picture. Let's further concentrate on the charging of electric vehicles. If we concentrate on those two things, and we would do nothing, electricity use would peak around 7 in the afternoon. This is not only a mismatch with the solar energy, but also expensive, because prices are highest during peaks in the demand. You can see that by the dotted line. So, we start smart charging the electric cars, and we assume they must always be fully charged when the user takes the electric car for a ride, so the user basically has no problem with it whatsoever. But that still gives us plenty of flexibility, so it's relatively easy to shift the charging towards the middle of the day without inconveniencing the user. Once more. Now, the price is much less volatile. The price is much less volatile in a new situation. In the old situation, it was volatile, now it's less volatile. This is a simplistic illustrative example, so it's just very simple. But it's also what we found in realistic situations where you don't only have electric vehicles and solar. Let's say we took a sample of 200 households in a real neighborhood and monitored their energy use. That's a dark mountain landscape that forms the base of the graph. As you can see, there is a little peak in the morning around 10 o'clock and a larger peak in the afternoon around 7 o'clock. The highest peak is around 160 kilowatts of power. You can see that in the graph. So that is what the local transformer in the electricity grid would see from these 200 households. Now let's give 20% of the households an electric vehicle, so 50 electric vehicles. In that case, we would see a sharp increase in the afternoon peak. You see it rises to about 220 kilowatts. This could mean that the transformer must be upgraded. or that extra wiring must be implemented to avoid a blackout. Both are costly investments. It would also mean that in some households, the voltage during peak times is now so low that it could damage their equipment. But with smart charging, we can completely avoid this higher peak. We can shift demand to the middle of the night, middle of the day. It's better for electricity grid, and it can hence lead to lower grid connection costs. Let's do this exercise again for the entire electricity grid in the Netherlands. So not only residential use, but also commercial and industrial electricity use. And let's replace all cars by electric vehicles. You can see that the afternoon peak on the grid rises from around 17,000 megawatts to around 25,000 megawatts. Now, if we introduce smart charging and we charge on the cheapest possible moment, the peak shifts to the middle of the day and the middle of the night. And this is with 50% of installed capacity from solar or wind, by the way. We see new peaks around 20,000 megawatts appearing in the middle of the night, which we can easily manage away, by the way, and the middle of the day. And actually, smart charging works so well that we get a new problem, but a smaller one. If we would tweak the smart charging algorithm, we could make this daily profile basically straight as a ruler. Isn't that great? But what does it mean for the electricity price that the user pays? In this specific situation, and taking the prices without taxes and without grid cost, the user would pay around 38% less for the electricity. This would save him around 7 euros, that's around 10 bucks, a month. You also see that the price becomes less volatile. In order for smart charging and the smart grid in general to work, we need to harness the power of the internet. Keep in mind that electricity grids have changed basically very little over the last century, and when they were built, computers were not around, let alone internet. Now, in order to use those computers, we should use what we learned from the internet and apply it to the grid. That's called a smart grid, basically. And probably the most important lesson from the internet is that open standards work. Firstly, they stimulate innovation because nobody owns them. So the goal should be no red tape, basically. Secondly, they avoid lock-in because they make equipment like ChargePoint interchangeable. For customers, that's a really good thing, and for society as a whole too, by the way. And in the end, this leads to better competition and lower costs. Governments have an important role here, not only because they should write the standards, but also because they could steer the process towards open standards. The simplest way to do this is to require open standards, as I said. The picture shows a whole range of relevant open standards, specifically for charge points. Two are more important than others. OSBP, which stands for Open Charge Point Protocol, and has nothing to do with the firm of the same name, standardizes how everything but a car interacts with a charge point. If your charge point is OSBP compliant, you can always switch it for another charge point. OCPI, the Open Charge Point Interface, connects users to the back office managing the charge point. In practice, this ensures that wherever you go, you can pay for your charging transaction, and roaming across countries, across nations becomes really easy. An especially interesting and hip new development is the use of so-called distributed ledger technology. You may know it as Bitcoin or blockchain. This is basically a list of verified transactions that can be shared by anyone. It's peer-to-peer, so you don't need a central party. Instead, it's like a booklet that you can pass around and everybody can use it to write down transactions. And as soon as you wonder what transactions did we make, everybody can look in the booklet. That way you can postpone charging your electric vehicle because you want to avoid a peak on the electricity grid. Right? So that's a little bit how it works. How does it more specifically, after you agree on a price, basically, right? So let's just play in transaction. you document agreement in the ledger. You say, my car will stop charging now and smart charging again at midnight. And somebody says, I will then provide you with 10 kilowatt hour of electricity for 50 cents, right? Now the contract is clear for everyone to see, it's definitive. If you start charging earlier, somebody can point to the ledger and say, you should be held to account. If somebody doesn't pay, it's equally clear. Now the only problem is that energy use of blockchain is growing off the charts. Fortunately, there are energy sipping alternatives that scale very well. One of them is Yoda. And just to prove that this can work, Elatnel recently made a charge point running exclusively Yoda. So, when the electricity grid was built, it was a very simple system with a couple of power plants mainly using coal. They put energy into the system, it would be pumped to the end users. Computers did not exist yet, so it had to be a pretty dumb system. It's basically how we distribute water using a water tower. We are moving towards a future in which solar, wind, and electric vehicles are not only cleaner alternatives, but also cheaper alternatives. And that means electricity flows through the network are now bidirectional. Furthermore, the new technologies are much more decentralized. Where there used to be dozens of power plants, you can now have thousands of wind turbines and millions of solar installations and electric vehicles. And not only do we have millions of unique machines, we have millions of unique owners and users. In order to use our new physical energy system efficiently, we need to harness the power of internet, we need to do smart charging. So next to the physical layer, we need to think about information technology layer. And in order to make this more advanced, we also need the contractual layer. An in-depth description of how this all could work is available in the lecture on smart charging in the technical track. But this is not only a technical matter, it's also a redistribution of money and power. The incumbents, such as the grid operator, the energy supplier, probably won't like it because it takes away their dominant role. But they will have to get used to it. I like to think it could democratize the way we distribute energy, and in that way you could say it's power to the people. Whatever you call it, whatever you want to achieve with it, one thing is clear. The electric vehicle provides more power and more storage capacity than any other machine in the smart grid, and for that reason alone, smart charging is really important. Thank you.